Let's discuss the different parts of a long bone. And we're going to use this image of a posterior femur quite a bit because it's really nice. It's the longest of your long bones. It's really nice in terms of visualizing these different parts. So the two main parts, you're going to have your epiphyses. And in the femur, you're actually going to have multiple epiphyses. These are going to be the ends of long bones. So important in terms of joint formation, that's what these epiphyses are going to join up with the epiphysis of another long bone. And then you're going to have the diaphysis in the middle and what's making up the bulk of the long bone. So sometimes you'll hear the term shaft or body of certain bones. These are all synonymous with diaphysis. So epiphyses and then diaphyses in the middle. Now, in a growing individual, you're going to have an additional component, and this is referred to as the metathesis. So this is going to be the region between the epiphysis and the diaphysis, and in a growing individual, this is going to be a block of hyaline cartilage. So you'll hear the term epiphyseal plate. And this epiphyseal plate is composed of hyaline cartilage, and that cartilage will actually grow. The cartilage will grow and then eventually be replaced by bone, so increasing the length of that diaphysis or the shaft of the bone. Now, once an individual reaches about 18 in terms of females, about 21 in terms of males, all these epiphyseal plates will be completely replaced by bone, and your bones will stop growing in terms of length. Now, there's other components of the bone that I want you to be familiar with, and some we've discussed in a little bit of detail. The articular cartilage is the first. So you'll have these on all those epiphyseal or ends of the long bones. So important in terms of additional shock absorption. Also important to note, this is going to be composed of cartilage. Cartilage does not have a very high blood supply. So without blood supply, that indicates that these type of tissues do not heal as well. So with damage to your articular cartilage, you're not going to have the replacement with new cartilage, and that's where you can get a lot of that bone pain in terms of joints. So you can have the bones actually rubbing up against one another, and that's a very bad thing. So articular cartilage you're going to have on all the ends of long bones. This is actually a remnant of the cartilage model that developed during bone formation. All right, we've discussed a little bit about the periosteum, and that's going to be that connective tissue that's going to surround all components of the bone except for in areas where the articular cartilage is. So the periosteum is composed of two different layers. You're going to have a tough, fibrous outer layer, and almost all outer layers, when we're talking about different areas of anatomy, are important in terms of protection. So you have a tough fibrous layer, and then you have a more inner osteogenic layer. And you remember how I was talking about those osteoblasts and osteoclasts, they're going to be sitting kind of in this in-between region between the bone and the periosteum. So important in terms of bones differentiating into osteoblasts and secreting that extracellular matrix. Also, you're going to have the what's referred to as perforating or Sharpey's fibers. These are going to be certain fibers that are actually going to enter into that bony matrix to really allow for a close adherence between the periosteum and the compact bone. All right, now the periosteum is going to surround the outer layers of the bone, and then within this region, you're going to have what's referred to as the medullary cavity. You can see that right here, the medullary cavity. Now, in dry bone, in bone that isn't living anymore, this is completely hollow. There's no neurovasculature in there, there's no bone marrow. But during life, it's a very important region in terms of that triglyceride storage, so that yellow bony marrow, as well as in terms of neurovasculature. And lining the edges of this medullary cavity is what's referred to as the endosteum. So kind of the counterpart of the periosteum, but within the medullary cavity. So very similar in terms of structure, in terms of a connective tissue structure. You'll also have a lot of osteoblasts and osteoclasts associated with the endosteum. One other thing I want you to note in terms of this is this very strong, prolific arterial or vasculature supply. So bone is going to have a lot of arterial supply, allowing for bone to continue to change throughout life, except for in this cartilaginous region. So really important in terms when we start getting into arthritis and so forth, this articular cartilage is going to play a big role.